McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents How to Profit in the Stock Market by Michael Sincere. Narrated by Steve Menasche. Publisher's note: this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. Preface. What you need to know first. I want to thank you for taking the time to buy my book, a follow-up to my best-selling book, Understanding Stocks. I wanted to write a book for traders and investors who were no longer beginners, which is how this book was created. In the first book, I taught you the basics, including how to buy and sell stocks and use fundamental and technical analysis. In this book, I have taken it up a few notches, digging deeper into indicators and oscillators, exploring buying and selling tactics, and also introducing a variety of strategies aimed at sophisticated traders and investors. I am excited about writing a book for those who are looking for higher-level strategies, tools, and ideas. Don't worry, I continue to explain the concepts in the same friendly tone and understandable language that helped make my other financial books so successful. I write this book as if we are having a conversation at the kitchen table. What you will learn. You are in the right place if you know the basics and want to learn more about the stock market. As always with my other books, I try to make this book educational as well as entertaining. My goal is to save you time and money while teaching you ways to increase income and build wealth. Before writing this book, I spent years testing and evaluating the stock market. I approached the stock market like a scientist, conducting numerous experiments to determine what worked and what didn't. As a result of my research, I was able to bring new insights and ideas to writing this book. I am very eager to share what I learned with you. My goal is to help you gain a deeper understanding of the stock market so you can increase profits over the short or long term. I took the classes, read the books, watched the videos, and talked to dozens of pros. I also invested and traded stocks, and along the way, I've made many mistakes, which I will help you to avoid. The bottom line is that you are listening to this book because you want to make money. One of the best ways to make that happen is by participating in the stock market, as either an investor or trader. By the time you finish this book, you should have learned a variety of different methods and strategies to succeed. Stock market risks. As your author, a job I take seriously, I want you to know that you need to know both the benefits and the risks of participating in the stock market. There are risks when you trade or invest, just as there are risks with anything else associated with the financial markets. Although you can never eliminate all risks, there are ways to minimize them. That means if you lose money in the market, although painful, it won't be devastating to your portfolio. That is why learning how to limit losses is so important. I am also realistic. Unfortunately, the market is not a fairy godmother that can solve all your financial obligations. Most of the time, stocks are an excellent investment. However, I also know that if you choose the wrong stock, or if the market drops, or if there is a correction, you can lose money. This is why one of my main goals is to help protect your stock positions from large losses. You don't want to be a sitting duck, which is why I will show you some of the clues to look for before the market falls. I'll even show you how to profit from market pullbacks and plunges. How the book is organized. In part one, you learn buying strategies as well as ways to find winning stocks. In fact, the ability to find potential winners is the first step in your journey as a short-term trader or investor. I discuss the most useful indicators and oscillators in part two, from moving averages to stochastics, including how they generate specific buy and sell signals. I gained additional insights by interviewing many of the creators of the most popular indicators, which I share with you. We'll cover trend following and momentum trading strategies in part three. I also included specific technical signals to help with buy and sell decisions. Many traders use one or both of these strategies, which is the reason I examine both the benefits and risks of each method. Anyone interested in high-risk, high-reward strategies will enjoy part four. That's when I introduce day trading, trading gaps, cryptocurrencies, and penny stocks. While these strategies are not for everyone, learning how they work may be useful. For many, they are pure entertainment. Because a bear market, correction, or crash is always looming, I want you to be prepared. In part five, I share the methods you should use not only to survive during volatile market environments, but to thrive. As an added bonus, I discuss how market pros, from seasoned investors to short sellers, handle bear markets. Speaking of short selling, I show you how to do it. Part 6 addresses tactics and strategies for selling stocks and options, what I call the art of selling. To close out the book, I discover how to sell covered calls. This easy-to-learn options strategy is ideal for anyone who owns stocks and wants to rent that stock to others. Even if you have no interest in using options, this strategy will be there if you're looking for income and cash flow. In the final chapter, I offer some parting advice on what to do next, along with good sources of further information and a glossary of indicators. Now is the time to get started. There has never been a better time to learn about and participate in the stock market. You have access to new technology, tools, and equipment that previous generations could only dream about. Most importantly, by the time you finish this book, you will learn when to enter and exit, when to buy and sell, and how to avoid the traps that ensnare most traders. There are many more strategies to learn, but at a minimum, my goal is to give you the information needed to succeed as a 21st century trader or investor. How to contact me. Thanks again for taking the time to listen to my book. I appreciate that of all the books you could have chosen, you chose mine. I will do my best to make you happy with that decision. My goal is to show you how to make a decent amount of money, a sum that varies for each person, on your own, so you don't have to rely on me or anyone else. I also hope that I inspire you to learn more about the stock market the same way that I did. Finally, if you have questions about my book or notice any errors, feel free to email me at msincere@gmail.com or visit my website, michaelsincere.com. I always enjoy hearing from you, and I'll try to answer promptly. Now, let's get to work. There is a lot to learn. Part 1. The Art of Buying. In this book, I am going to act as your personal tour guide, showing you many different paths to helping you achieve your financial goals. The first step in this process is identifying which stocks to buy. Not everyone realizes it, but there is an art to buying stocks. The scientific aspect of the stock market is technical analysis, which you will learn about in Part 2. The artistic part includes not only interpreting the signals correctly, but making the right trade at the right time. In Part 1, I will show you many helpful tactics and strategies. The hard part of trading is not just making a profit, but keeping that profit. This is a challenge for all market participants. For example, let's say that two great stock pickers, Warren Buffett and Peter Lynch, told you that they liked company YYYY Manufacturing, not a real company, because its earnings were expected to substantially increase over the next several years. They recommend that you buy YYYY stock. The next morning, after the market opens, you sign into your account and buy 400 shares of YYYY. Guess what? The odds are very good that 1 month from today, instead of making the huge profits you dreamed about, you will have lost money. How is this possible? This story is common among traders. Traders and investors often buy good stocks, but at the wrong time. Others buy at a good time, but watch all their profits disappear because they ignored the sell signals. Others buy stocks and lose patience and sell right before the stock price takes off. I'll tell you the truth. While it's easy to teach the scientific part of trading, technical and fundamental analysis, it's a challenge to teach how to buy and sell for profits. For example, if you get too emotionally involved with a stock or misread the technical signals, your outcome is likely to be poor. The good news is that you can improve your trading skills with practice and the right trading book. I wonder which one. No one said it's easy to make a profit, but I will explain how to do so. As you'll also discover, potential winners are everywhere. The key is knowing how to separate the wheat from the chaff, the winners from the losers. You may be asking, if it's so easy to find winners, why isn't everyone making money in the stock market? Good question. By the end of the book, I hope you will join that fortunate group of traders and investors who not only find winning stocks, but also earn money from them. And now, let's get started learning how to find winning stocks. Note: I assume you already know the mechanics of how to enter orders to buy and sell stocks. If not, the step-by-step procedures are thoroughly discussed in my previous book, Understanding Stocks. Chapter 1. Find Winning Stocks. No matter how good your strategy, equipment, or technical indicators, if you choose the wrong stock, you are likely to lose money. Therefore, one of the keys to succeeding as a trader or investor is to find a potential winner. That is what you will learn to do in this chapter, and I can't stress how important it is. There are many ways to discover winning stocks. Most traders use technical analysis. Some look at fundamental information, while others use scanning software from their brokerage. There is no best method because it's a personal choice. Before you can find a winner, you need search criteria. Obviously, nearly all market participants have different opinions about which stocks will make it to the winner's circle. The important part is choosing the right stock at the right time. If you can do that, your chances of making money for the day, week, month, or longer are good. On the other hand, if you choose a losing stock, no matter how skilled you are as a trader, the chances are high that you will lose money. You must also be cautious about buying stocks recommended by a know-it-all, tout on TV, or uninformed acquaintances. Many times, these stocks turn out to be duds. These stocks should be put on your watch list, which you will learn about in the sidebar at the end of this chapter. Throughout this book, I show you various ways to find winners while avoiding losers. Often, I mention a number of trophy stocks that have performed well in the past. However, note that although learning about stocks from the past is helpful, my focus is on helping you find stocks that may succeed in the future. As economic conditions change and the years go by, so will the list of potential winners. Many of the successful stocks mentioned in this book may fall out of favor as technology advances and economic conditions change. I encourage you to carefully consider which criteria to choose. Don't worry if you don't know where to start. In this chapter, I give you ideas of what to look for when buying stocks. The stock ideas can be used for any strategy covered in this book, including trend, momentum, swing, and position trading. Choose stocks that are suitable for the strategy and method that you use or plan to use. How to find a winning stock. As you heard earlier, winning stocks are everywhere. You get ideas from financial websites, magazine articles, money managers, and TV personalities who throw out dozens of stock picks. Nearly everyone has stock tips, and people freely share them with you. Here are some of the criteria to look for when finding strong stocks that have the potential to move higher or lower if you are betting against the market. These are the kind of stocks that both traders and investors usually want to trade. Note: you aren't limited to choosing stocks. For example, many traders prefer to trade ETFs, exchange-traded funds. The three most popular and most liquid ETFs are SPY, QQQ, and IWM, which track the S&P 500, NASDAQ, and Russell 2000, respectively. Another choice is to trade individual sectors such as technology, retail, pharmaceuticals, or commodities. Note: although I'll show you how to find winning stocks, another idea is to use the scanning software on your broker's website to find candidates that meet the criteria that you set. You don't have any criteria? Don't worry. You will get dozens of ideas when hearing about the indicators and oscillators in Part 2. Stock buying ideas. The following ideas should get you started thinking about how to find winning stocks. Keep a trading diary to write down any new prospects. Some of the best ideas come from the products that you buy, the stores where you shop, and the services that you use. Idea number one: look for stocks making 52-week highs or lows. One of the easiest ways to find potential winners is to look at the list of stocks making new 52-week highs or lows. These lists are in your broker's software or at numerous investment websites such as MarketWatch, Yahoo Finance, Google Finance, Barron's, The Wall Street Journal, Bar Chart, CNN Money, and Market Chameleon. Stocks that are trading at or near their all-time highs get the most attention. The 52-week high list is like bees to honey to momentum and trend traders who often buy stocks near all-time highs. On the other hand, contrarian traders may bet against these same stocks. Many institutions, such as mutual funds and hedge funds, are also interested in stocks that trade at one-year highs. At the end of every quarter, many managers flock to stocks making all-time or one-year highs while dumping losers. Owning winning stocks help make money managers look smart, which keeps clients happy while also attracting new money from investors. Idea number two. Find stocks with high volume. Stocks powered by strong volume often turn into short and long-term holdings. Volume is the fuel that forces stocks higher or lower. The higher the volume, the stronger the trend, which increases the potential that the stock is going to be a keeper. One advantage of buying high-volume stocks is that they are liquid, easy to buy and sell. Liquid stocks are actively traded. 1 million or more shares traded daily. On the other hand, stocks that are illiquid tend to have wider bid-ask spreads, making it difficult to get a good execution on your trade. Therefore, look for stocks with higher than normal volume. The brute force of high volume makes some of these stocks unstoppable, especially during a bull market. These stocks have the potential to be big winners. You also want to identify stocks with high relative volume. These are stocks whose volume has recently increased by so much that they deserve your attention. For example, if a stock that normally trades 1 million shares is now trading 10 million shares, it should be put on your watch list. More than likely, institutions have discovered the stock. It's often a good idea to find stocks with strong institutional backing. Note: there are traders who have no interest in buying the generals, that is, the most well-known and most actively traded stocks. Instead, they prefer buying lesser-known, low-priced stocks using momentum strategies. Some of these low-liquidity stocks are easy to buy but difficult to sell at a price that's good for you. Because some traders love these strategies and these stocks, I discuss the pros and cons of buying momentum stocks in Chapter 10. Idea number three. Find stocks moving higher in the pre-market. Here's a strategy. Identify stocks that are already moving higher by 1 or 2% or more in the pre-market. Stocks that spurt out of the starting gate up by 1 or 2% or 1 or 2 points for some stocks are likely to keep moving higher all morning and perhaps all day or longer. There is no guarantee that they will continue to move higher after the opening bell, because much depends on the overall market environment. In addition, some stocks that start off strong at the open stall and reverse direction. It's relatively easy to identify stocks that are early winners. The hard part is finding the ones that continue trending higher all day or all week. Obviously, finding winning stocks is only your first step. You should listen to this entire book to learn how to enter at the right time and exit with a profit. Typically, you need technical analysis for guidance. Important. A stock opening higher isn't enough reason to buy it. Track the winners and try to determine which have the most potential. Under no circumstances should you chase stocks, especially those that move extremely high at the open, gapping stocks. Sometimes, stocks surge higher after the market opens but stall and quickly reverse. The main point is that stocks that start strong at the opening bell and are backed by a bullish market environment have an excellent chance of trending higher all day. These stocks are true winners and many are unstoppable, at least for the day, and perhaps longer. Trading note. If you decide to trade these stocks, don't make the mistake of placing a trade in the first 5 minutes, what traders call amateur hour. The conflicting orders at the open are so volatile, it's easy to get whipsawed, resulting in a poor fill. Buying strategies will be discussed thoroughly in Chapter 2. Note. Some of the websites that list stocks moving higher or lower in the pre-market include MarketWatch, CNN Money, Yahoo Finance, Google Finance, Market Chameleon, and Bar Chart. Idea number 4. Identify stocks in a trading range. Some traders or short-term investors may want to look for stocks that move in a predictable trading range, for example, between $40 and $50 per share. With this strategy, buy when the stock moves close to the lower range, such as the $40 in this example, and reduce or sell the position at the upper range, such as at $50. The good news is there are always stocks like these waiting to be discovered. To look for candidates, scan through long-term stock charts. In the old days, General Electric and IBM were ideal candidates. You could buy near the bottom of a trading range and sell at the top. For years, investors could depend on stocks like these to stay in a well-defined range and not break out lower or higher. On occasion, stocks trading in a range move much higher. They break out, delighting investors and traders alike. In recent years, stocks such as Apple, Alphabet, Netflix, and many others have broken above resistance and never looked back. Note. Stocks that trade within a trading range have both a support and a resistance price, which we will discuss in Chapter 3. In the example before, $40 was the support level and $50 was the resistance level. When a stock breaks above resistance, that is when many traders and investors get excited about the short and long-term prospects of the company. Many consider it as a buying opportunity. Idea number 5. Buy the steady eddies. There is nothing more satisfying than finding a steady eddy stock that moves in a stable, relatively steady direction, typically higher, with only a few hiccups along the way. A few of the stocks that have fit this criterion are Walmart, Home Depot, Lowe's, and Johnson & Johnson. Because these stocks went higher for years, buying such stocks was a profitable venture. Steady Eddie stocks can generate consistent profits year after year. As you listen to this book, be on the lookout for other stocks that have superb fundamentals and are in an uptrend. They are often well-known stocks favored by large institutions, but are often not exciting enough for some retail investors. Banks and insurance company stocks are often excellent candidates, the kind of stocks that Warren Buffett likes to buy, even if some of them may put you to sleep. Perhaps some of these stocks aren't as sexy as the go-go stocks favored by some traders, but as long as they keep moving higher, it's hard to go wrong owning them, especially as many also pay rich dividends. Caveat. Although many stocks mentioned here were ideal nominees at one time, there is no guarantee that they will be in the future. That is why it's important to continue looking for new candidates. Idea number 6. Find stocks with relative strength. Look for individual stocks that move in a different direction from the overall market. For example, if the entire market is declining, but a handful of stocks are flat or moving higher, these stocks should be put on your watch list and monitored for possible bullish moves. Based on relative strength, these stocks have outperformed the index and probably many other securities. To be precise, relative strength is a ratio that compares the stock price performance with an index, sector, or another stock over a given time period. A stock diverging higher from the overall market is said to have relative strength. Put another way, the stock has outperformed the overall market or index. Conversely, stocks moving lower from the overall market are said to have relative weakness. It's one of the oldest ideas among traders and can lead to discovering winning stocks. Stocks that have strong relative strength are often the first to recover when the market moves higher after a sell-off and after the stock has bottomed. They survive the sell-off and benefit from the upside reversal. This is just one of many reasons why it's useful to understand and apply relative strength when selecting which stocks to purchase. Note: do not confuse the term relative strength discussed before with the relative strength index, RSI, which you'll hear about in Chapter 5. Idea number 7. Find home run stocks. Search for stocks that within months have the potential to move 15 to 25% from entry to exit. The idea is to let one of these beauties do its magic and bloom until it fully matures. Finding a home run stock is not easy. Such stocks are often hiding in plain sight and may not be included on the watch lists of many traders. In hindsight, one of the greatest home run trades in history was when Apple fell below $6 per share in the 1990s. After Steve Jobs triumphantly returned to create the Apple iPod, the rest is history. Although Apple was the perfect home run stock, opportunities such as this don't come around very often. It's also not an easy trade because there was a risk that Apple was not going to recover from its debacle. The ideal time to find a home run stock is typically after a major pullback or correction. That means searching for a seriously oversold stock that has been temporarily thumped. Find one of these diamonds in the rough and you have the potential to hit a home run. This strategy is for anyone willing to wait for a rare opportunity to profit from special situations, such as when there is blood in the streets. While everyone else is running away in fear from the stock market, you are shopping for beaten-up stocks that are temporarily in the doghouse. Choose the right stock and you can make substantial profits. trading note. Once you have identified a home run candidate, and after receiving a buy signal, consider scaling into the trade, rather than using the lump sum investment method. The key to success with this method is waiting for a buy signal. After buying, give the stock time to develop and mature. This is not a short-term trade, but a position trade, holding for several months or longer. Sit and wait until your profit goals have been achieved, and if not, cut your losses. Idea number 8. Don't forget the fundamentals. In this book, we are primarily focused on technical analysis. However, as I discussed in my companion book, Understanding Stocks, I encourage you to consider assets, liabilities, and other fundamental data when searching for stock candidates. Stocks with excellent fundamentals typically have increased sales and earnings over several years, may pay dividends, and have little or no debt. Fundamental data is available on your brokerage firm's website or on the internet sites mentioned in the resources section at the end of the book. Often, studying fundamental information is an ideal starting place when searching for stocks to buy. Famed mutual fund manager Peter Lynch used fundamental analysis to find reasonably priced stocks in top-notch companies. He studied a company's balance sheet to help identify companies whose stocks he wanted to own. Lynch was always on the hunt for stocks that had the potential to return 10 times their initial cost. He called these stocks 10-baggers, a term he coined. These home-run stocks have extremely strong earnings and also represent a good value. My hope is that you now have some ideas about which stocks to buy, and in the next chapter, when we discuss technical analysis, there will be more ideas. As your list of stock candidates grows, you need to monitor them. That is why it's important to create a watch list. Create a watch list. Maintaining an up-to-date watch list is essential to your success as a trader. It is a list of stocks, ETFs, or other securities that you follow and would consider owning. Every brokerage firm makes it easy to create one or multiple watch lists using its software. For example, you could create a list of stocks in a certain sector, such as technology or retail, or a list of low-priced stocks that you may want to buy, or even a list of stocks derived from tip-givers, tipsters. The first step is to add stocks that meet your criteria. The watch list can include as few or as many stocks as you can easily monitor. Your list can range from a few dozen and up, but many professionals have lists in the hundreds. The watch list contains basic information, such as the stock quote, volume, and other important trade details. You can view the watch list on an iPad or other tablet, a computer, or a smartphone. Many stocks on your watch list will have a high correlation to the overall stock market and represent the core group of stocks that you monitor. Another popular method for finding potential winners is using a stock screener. A stock screener is an excellent method to search for stocks with any technical or fundamental criteria that you enter. As you listen to this book, you will think of your own criteria, such as stocks that have made 52-week highs or lows. Your broker should have a stock screener as part of its trading software. In addition, financial websites that have stock screeners include Yahoo Finance, Google Finance, Bar Chart, MarketWatch, FinViz, MSN Money, Market Chameleon, and others. Note: Your watch list should also include the three major indexes: Dow Jones Industrial Average, DJIA, Standard & Poor's 500, SPX, and NASDAQ Composite Index, IXIC. At a minimum, ETFs such as SPY and QQQ should be included on your watch list. Now that I have given you a few ideas on how to find winning stocks, and I know you will discover others, in the next chapter, I'll introduce a number of buying tactics that may be helpful. Chapter 2: Buying Strategies and Tactics. In this chapter, I will introduce a number of buying strategies. What is the difference between the amateur trader and a professional? The pros have trading strategies, tactics, and ideas thought out in advance. Few experienced traders make impulsive, emotional purchases, and neither should you. After finding a potential winner, many traders immediately buy the stock, sometimes within minutes after the opening bell. If you find a potential winner, don't feel like you have to buy it right now. If you are overwhelmed with a frantic feeling, I strongly recommend not making the trade. It is important to learn that right now is seldom a good time to make a new trade. If anything, it may be the right time to exit a bad trade. Any stock you buy based on fear or greed often turns into a loser. Others are so afraid of missing out on the trade that they load the boat with as many shares as they can afford. All they can think about is the money they may lose by not making the trade. This emotional ailment, known as FOMO, fear of missing out, is common with anxious traders. To help you with the buying decision, the following are three buying strategies. Choose the ones that make the most sense to you. The first buying idea, scaling into an investment, is a clever way of buying without making huge bets. This is one way to minimize risk. Idea number one, scaling into an investment. After deciding that a stock is worth buying, many traders use the lump sum investment method. They buy as many shares as they can afford to or want to buy. For example, they may buy 1,000 shares of a stock at one time. While this method has some advantages, dropping a fistful of dollars on any old stock can be risky, especially if the stock moves in the wrong direction. A more strategic buying method is scaling into an investment. For example, let's say that you are interested in buying XYZ. Instead of investing $1,000 at one time, consider investing $200 in XYZ at first. Put another way, you stagger the purchases over a short or long time period, using only a portion of your capital with each installment. After making that initial purchase, sit back and see how the stock performs. I recommend that you give the stock some time to simmer before adding additional shares. If the stock price doesn't budge, let it marinate before adding to the position. Scaling into a trade is a powerful risk management method, one you should consider using. Although you can't control stock prices, you do have control over the size of your trade. This is one of your best weapons to control risk. Scaling into winners. If the stock in the example before moves higher after you buy it, feel free to spend another $200 at an appropriate time. Listen to the next section for more specific advice. This buying strategy involves scaling into winners as they move higher. Scaling into winners is distasteful to many traders whose mantra is to buy low and sell high. The idea of buying at higher prices goes against everything these traders were taught. If you can't stand to buy stocks at higher prices, then you may not like this scaling method. Nevertheless, I recommend seriously considering it. Scaling higher tactics. If you use the scaling higher method mentioned before, you may wonder when you should add to your position. That is an excellent question. In fact, the most important trade when scaling higher is not the first trade, it is the second trade. It will determine the success or failure of your strategy. Be sure that any additional purchases are strategic and not random. The first trade is easier because it is made when the stock is on its way higher. The hope is the stock continues moving up, and if not, quickly cut your losses at a predetermined price. As long as the stock rises steadily, slowly scale into the position. If you are right about the stock price direction, then your position will be profitable. As the stock moves higher, there will be a point when you should stop scaling in. This is the tricky part. One such time occurs when you are fully invested. That is, the $1,000 you allocated for this position has been invested. In other words, don't mindlessly scale in whenever you feel like it, but do so based on a plan. The last thing you want to do is add to a winning position that is overbought and at risk of reversing. This is the so-called bull trap, a painful experience that bullish traders want to avoid. Don't scale into losers. If the stock you just bought takes a turn in the wrong direction, you'll be glad that you committed only $200 to this position. In this example, instead of losing $1,000, you limited the loss to only $200. Important. If your initial purchase loses money, don't buy more shares. Adding to a losing position is what is known as trying to catch a falling knife, something you don't want to do. Remind yourself with this saying, only losers add to losers. Idea number two, buying the dip. Many traders love buying the dip, or buying stocks as prices decline, hoping to make a purchase at the lowest possible price. This strategy is taught at many finance schools and is recommended in many books and on numerous websites. After all, buying low and selling high is the goal of many connected to the financial markets. For buying the dip to work, you must have a plan, strategy, or system. The market is mad enough. Don't add to the craziness by buying without a strategy. Some of the best dip buying candidates are stocks that you know and have been watching for weeks, months, or years. When one of your stocks on your watch list has a setback, some traders buy the dip. Did I say this was easy? No, it takes some probing to get it right. Sure, sometimes impulsive buyers get lucky and make a profit on a spontaneous buy-the-dip position, but one day their luck may run out. That is why it's so important to have a well-thought-out plan. Reminder. If you're going to buy the dip, use the scaling strategy discussed earlier. Rather than buying with one lump sum, stagger your purchase over a short time period. When the dip keeps dipping. One of the problems with the buy-the-dip strategy is when the dipping stock doesn't reverse but keeps falling. Before you know it, you could be painfully behind on the trade. That's when many amateurs refuse to sell or even add to the losing position. Some started off as traders and switched to being stockholders when the stock doesn't recover. In some cases, they are stuck in the losing position for years. Some traders justify the losing trade by claiming they are dollar cost averaging, that is, investing a set amount of money for a set time period over the long term. I'm sorry, you can't switch from a dip buyer to dollar cost averaging unless you're afflicted with a bad case of hopium. Here's some advice. If a trade is going against you, stop buying the dip and exit. Don't throw good money after bad. Note: keep in mind that buying the dip is a market timing strategy designed to take advantage of short-term pullbacks. The trader's plan is to profit from the sale price and accumulate additional stock. Dips may not last long, so waiting for an even lower price may not be a good idea. When buying the dip stops working. Buying the dip works because the market trends higher most of the time. Unfortunately, it won't work well during a long-term bear market. If you buy the dip during a downtrending market, you may wish you hadn't. When the market sells off, there is a flood of financial experts telling you to buy the dip because stocks are on sale. Others announce that stocks are too cheap to sell. Let me be clear. There is nothing wrong with buying the dip, but do it right. Use the tools and strategies that are included in this book. This is a better method than playing it by ear, listening to tip givers, or making impulsive trades. Note: the brilliant financier and trader Bernard Baruch once quipped, "Don't try to buy at the bottom or sell at the top. It can't be done except by liars." He once said that the secret to his stock market success was that he always bought too late and sold too early. I mention this only to help you think differently about the market. Just because the majority on Wall Street tells you to buy low and sell high, buy the dip, that doesn't mean it is correct. Idea number 3. Buying high and selling higher. Those who love to buy the dip may be repelled by this popular trend-following strategy: buying high and selling higher. Buying high works as long as you don't cross over the line to chasing, which is easy to do. By the end of this book, the distinction will be clear. If you make the mistake of chasing, the financial pain could be severe. If your plan is to buy stocks as they move higher, add stocks that are at or near their 52-week highs to your watch list. The idea is to ride the wave of a strong uptrend. Sometimes, specific stocks keep moving higher for days, weeks, months, and even years. If you can catch one of these winners, you'll be in good shape for a long time, depending on your trading strategy. The risks of buying high. When buying stocks at their highs, in a way, you are rolling the dice and hoping the upward momentum continues. If it does, then the strategy works brilliantly. On the other hand, when stocks are in rarefied, overbought territory, any negative news or other hiccups can send the stocks reeling backward. It takes a strong belief in the strategy and in the stock to hold when short sellers are licking their chops, ready to pounce on a stock that has moved too far and too fast and is at risk of reversing direction. While it is wonderful to buy winning stocks at their highs and to see them move higher, be sure to limit risk. That means not accumulating too many shares, no matter how much you love the stock or its story. Note: to stay out of trouble, always think about risk first and reward second. That means waiting for a good entry point by using technical analysis. The goal is to be a more strategic trader than the quickest trader in the market. Warning: do not double down. Do you want to lose all your money really fast? Then follow the tactics of amateur traders who attempt to increase their risk and profits by doubling their bets. When right, they feel like geniuses. When wrong, they lose big time. Based on probabilities, the odds are not in your favor when using the double-down strategy. Even worse, some traders bet more than they can afford on a position they are certain will be a winner. Sometimes they win, sometimes they lose, but over the long term, the chances are good they will get wiped out. Betting the farm on one position is not trading, it's gambling. Another hazardous to your wealth strategy includes plunging into a position in an effort to get rich fast. Infamous trader Jesse Livermore plunged multiple times, one of the reasons he went bankrupt on three occasions. Ultimately, he tripled down on the short side of the market in October 1929. And this time, he was on the winning side, earning over $100 million in 1 week after the market crashed. It was his greatest payday, making him one of the richest men in the world. The problem was that he couldn't stop doubling down. Livermore continued to plunge into stocks and commodities using this highly risky strategy, even though he was one of the best stock pickers in the world. After plunging one too many times, within 5 years, all his money had disappeared. Note: doubling down is for gamblers, not traders. While the payoff can be amazing when you're right, it may wipe out your account if wrong. It's almost always a mistake to rely on Lady Luck.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.